Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Biology. Imagine you just finished a pretty rigorous hike up a mountain. You're taking in the gorgeous views, but also your heart is racing and you're trying to catch your breath. This is your circulatory and respiratory systems at work, trying to bring your body back to homeostasis. Every cell in your body needs oxygen and nutrients to survive, and it is the job of your respiratory and circulatory systems to get these to the cells in your body. Today's lesson will follow the path of oxygen and nutrients through your body so that you can better understand these vital organ systems. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to identify the main structures of the circulatory and respiratory systems. Describe the flow of oxygen through the body. Describe the flow of blood through the heart. The circulatory system is well known for its role in moving blood throughout the body. However, did you also know that it is responsible for carrying waste away from cells, as well as maintaining a stable body temperature? Yeah, all of these jobs are accomplished by the circulatory system moving blood throughout the body. The circulatory system is found in every part of the body, from your fingertips to your heart, but is made of only three main structures. The heart of the circulatory system is the heart! Seriously though, the heart is the powerhouse of the circulatory system, pumping blood throughout the body. The blood vessels are like the roads and highways for the blood so that it can move throughout the entire body, bringing oxygen and nutrients and removing carbon dioxide and waste. Let's spend some time learning more about these key features of this important body system. Blood vessels are like highways and roads throughout the body. There are three main types of blood vessels: arteries, veins, and capillaries. When oxygenated blood leaves the heart, it flows through arteries. Eventually, the blood reaches the capillaries. Capillaries are smaller blood vessels located between the arteries and veins. It's in these capillaries that the oxygen and nutrients leave the blood to go nourish the tissues, and waste is transferred to the blood to start making its way out of the body. After stopping at the transfer station, the capillaries, the blood moves into the veins to head back to the heart so that the waste can make its way out of the body. Blood is a complex component of the circulatory system. It is made of a mixture of cells that are suspended in the blood plasma, which is a liquid substance made in the bone marrow. The red blood cells are probably what you think of when you picture your blood, which makes sense because these cells make up 44% of the volume of the blood. It has one main job, but it is an important one. The red blood cells are responsible for transporting oxygen around the body. They are the perfect curved shape for holding oxygen. It is almost like the oxygen is riding an inner tube on a lazy river as it makes its way through the body. The white blood cells only make up 1% of the blood volume, but are very important. These cells are part of the immune system and help your body fight infection. The last blood component are the platelets. If you think back to our lesson on homeostasis, we talked about how platelets are involved in a positive feedback loop. When you sustain a cut, the release of a chemical signal from your platelets brings additional platelets to the affected area. This process helps to form a blood clot and promotes healing. If you are able to, take your hands and make them into fists and hold them in the center of your chest, knuckles together. This is approximately the size of your heart. Your heart is a relatively small but very mighty organ. The heart has four chambers, two atria, which are the top chambers that fill with blood coming back from the body and lungs, and two ventricles, which are the lower chambers that receive blood from the atria to then pump out into the body. While the body has 34 major veins, the largest is the vena cava. The vena cava is the vein that leads into the right atrium, carrying deoxygenated blood, or blood that is not carrying oxygen, into the heart. The aorta is the largest artery in the body. It is the artery that leads out of the left ventricle of the heart, carrying oxygenated blood, or blood that is carrying oxygen, out and into the rest of the body. Both of these blood vessels are vital passageways on the highway that are the blood vessels of the body. If they are injured or impaired, there is the potential of major health implications. Ever ride on a roller coaster? It is a complicated route of loops and turns, but there is only one route that the ride can follow. That is similar to the blood flow through the heart. It is a complicated ride, but there is a specific path that the blood follows. As the blood enters the heart from the body, it flows through the vena cava and enters the right atrium. The right atrium contracts, which pushes the blood into the right ventricle. When the right ventricle contracts, it pushes the blood out of the heart and through the body to the lungs, where it picks up oxygen. The oxygenated blood then travels back to the heart and enters the left atrium. As the left atrium contracts, it pushes the oxygenated blood into the left ventricle and finally out of the heart through the aorta, carrying oxygen around the body. While talking about the circulatory system, we use the term oxygenated blood a lot. Oxygen is vital to our body. It can't function without it. However, how do we get oxygen into our bodies? We breathe it in! Taking that deep breath in is the first step in the respiratory system. While the respiratory system is known for its main role of gas exchange in the body, it is also involved in speech and vocalization and smell. There are two types of gas exchange that happen within the body: external gas exchange and internal gas exchange. External gas exchange occurs between the atmosphere and the blood and occurs in the lungs. Internal gas exchange takes place at the capillaries in the circulatory system and occurs between the blood and the cells in the body. In this part of the lesson, we are going to focus on external gas exchange. The respiratory tract is the path that air takes as you inhale and exhale. It is the organs that your body uses when breathing. I want you to take a deep breath. Imagine an air particle entering your body as you inhale, traveling around the body, and then out as you exhale. Okay, let's talk about the path that an oxygen molecule would have taken and what is happening in your body when you take that deep breath. As you inhale, the oxygen enters your nasal cavity where it is cleaned, moistened, and filtered. It then travels down the pharynx to enter the rest of your respiratory system. On its way, it passes through the larynx. Your larynx is more commonly called your voice box. It uses cartilage and vibrations to make sounds such as speech. Below the larynx, the air particle will reach the trachea, also called the windpipe. This is a flexible tube that leads further down, eventually breaking into two smaller tubes called bronchi that enter the lungs. Once the air is in the lungs, it continues through even smaller tubes, bronchioles, and eventually comes to an end at the alveoli, which are clusters of tiny sacs where the gas exchange occurs. These alveoli are only one cell thick and surrounded by capillaries. This is where oxygen enters the blood and carbon dioxide is removed. The oxygen molecule is now part of the circulatory system, and the carbon dioxide follows a reverse path back up the respiratory system and out the nasal cavity. As we went through the lesson today, we learned how the circulatory system and respiratory system work together to supply our bodies with oxygen. In our next lesson, we will continue our study of the human body and look at the digestive and excretory systems. Until next time, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey. See you next time.